Good evening and welcome to the Newport City Council's Candidate Forum. This evening we're at the Goodrich Memorial Library and we are also filming it for NEKTV and it is being broadcast live on WIKE as we speak. So that means none of the candidates can swear tonight. FCC rules and regulations do apply. Well, I don't think we're going to do that anyway. So I'd say we will get this underway in just a couple minutes. I'll give you a quick rundown of how the format for the evening is going to go. I didn't introduce myself. I'm sorry. My name is Todd Pronto. I am from NEKTV. And I am your moderator this evening. So what we'll do is we will introduce each of the candidates. We'll start on the very far my right, so your left, and we'll work our way down. Each candidate is going to have 2 minutes to answer a question that I will read in just a few minutes. Then after that, we're going to go through a list of questions, and I have Penny here, who is going to be picking the questions from a basket and handing it to me and making sure that I know how to read, so hopefully I can read legibly, and that'll be the question that the next candidate in line gets. So it'll be a separate question for each candidate. It'll be drawn from the hat. At the end, we're time permitting, we'll take some questions from the audience, and then they'll have closing statements. Ira Morgan was not able to attend tonight. He's one of the candidates. He had to work, so we have these six people we'll introduce in just a moment. I think the last thing that I need to mention to the candidates is we have a bell that Pam is going to ring. When that rings, that means the 2 minutes is up. And so we can get as many questions in, we're going to try to adhere to the time as best as possible. So without further ado, I think we'll start on the very far left, which would be Dan Ross. And the question is, and you all have the same question, correct?
So we're going to start with that, or are you just going to introduce everybody first?
Actually, that's a good idea. I'll introduce you all, and then we'll do the question. So, thank you. I only do this about once every 2 years, so I'm warming up. Dan Ross is down on the very far left. Next to him is James Merriam. Next to him is Kevin Charbonneau. Next to him is Woody Page. Next to him is Julie Raboyne. And next to her, and in between me and Julie, is John Wilson. And the first question that, and they all answered this first question. And I can repeat it when it gets to you if you'd like. But we'll start with Dan. What positive steps has the city of Newport made in the past year? And if elected, where would you focus your energy to move the city forward?
What I did is I noted several small things. Improvements in the infrastructure. One of the streets on the Glen Road was dug up, new sewer lines, new water lines, and repaved. So, you know, to me that is a very important thing for the city. I think the Centennial Committee has brought a lot of people together and have moved that ahead so they were going to have a wonderful time this year. They're very important to the people. Downtown designation was renewed, which gives a lot of opportunity for businesses. And we need opportunities for businesses. I look at the city as a whole and not just a hole in the ground. And I think overall, we live in a wonderful community. And how would I move that forward? I think we have to focus on our infrastructure. If we're going to bring business to the city, we have to have a clean city, working water, working sewer, up to date.
All right, thank you. And the same question will be for James Merritt.
All right, wonderful. Thank you all for being here. Good evening. So it's been a great pleasure to serve on the City Council for the last just about year, and the things I've had the opportunity to work on have been, there's been a lot of interesting topics, but ones I would single out are, really I think there's been a lot of growth and a lot of progress made in burying the hatchet regarding the Bluff Farm, and embracing, I think, the opportunities for city and land trust partnerships to gain some of the great grants that we've already achieved and more still to come. I would say I would really praise the work of the water department, especially as some of the infrastructure upgrades that have already been referenced. And just say that we are in a wonderfully solid position. We really, as a city, pull well above our weight in terms of services, in terms of community, in terms of just being such a crossroads in this greater area and such, in, such an anchor point. I would say going forward, we're, of course, it's to continue with the good direction we're going in, to work to present and bring a new situation to the city, a new tourist angle, and I think that especially means looking to our neighbors to the north, embracing shared culture and the huge population, and just folks looking to take advantage of what we have to offer. We're a beautiful community in a beautiful part of the world, and it's been, I think, being a relatively new member of this community, it's just, I have the angle of getting to see just what a gem there is without having come to take it for granted. So I think we have many opportunities in terms of tourism, in terms of attracting business, and especially making our community more walkable and more bike friendly.
Thank you. Same question for Kevin Sherman.
Currently, there are some things in the works for the city of Newport, which I believe we should support as we continue to move forward. One of them that comes to mind is the formation of the countywide dispatch services. This will allow valuable info on how and where emergency services are sent. It'll provide accountability. The ability to customize dispatching services for our area. For example, some departments have an auto accident, want police, fire, and ambulance. Some departments don't. And essentially, that would give us more local control, which we lost when the state police removed dispatching services. The town has seen improvements made to the aesthetic appeal of the city. We have walking paths that have been built and more are in the works. Something as simple and nice as the flowers and the median of the causeway. There have been upgrades on the sidewalks, removing the pavement and laying bricks. And in the past several years, community gardens have been planted. These are all things that are in the works, and we should continue and support them. Another large issue facing Newport is the water tower.
And another ring, a phone ring. I'm going to actually repeat the question for those that are just tuning in to the radio station, but each candidate here is getting 2 minutes to respond to this question. What positive steps has the city of Newport made in the past year, and if elected, where would you focus your energy to move our city forward? The next candidate to speak is Woody Page.
The two positive items that I feel that the city has moved forward on is the first one being the ReNewport community meetings and visit, which have taken place. I think it's brought a lot of Newporters together, as well as outsiders interacting with Newporters. So I think that's a positive event. The other item is the allocation of monies for the Newport Renaissance Corporation. There's been a total of $60,000 that's been allocated, and hopefully that there will be the discovery of that person, and he'll be the right person that will do the work to develop the hole in the ground. Some other ideas that I have where I would like to focus my energy, I have a number of them. I think the first one and the primary one for all of us might be jobs, keeping those jobs that we have here in the area, as well as trying to attract companies to our area with jobs. Other continued improvements would be our schools, perhaps a daycare center, supporting a daycare center, marketing and advertising, trying to attract people to our area, perhaps tax incentives for families to move here. We also need to work on our recreational areas. Gardner Park needs a great deal of improvements, and I think it's time that we improve that park. And I guess one other thing is, before we even start working on the hole in the ground, one thing we need to do is get some of our vacant buildings on Main Street, get something into those buildings. Before we even start work on the hole in the ground, we need to ensure that we have those buildings have something in them.
Thank you. Next candidate is Julie Ramone.
Well, I'm thinking Woody might have looked on my paper because there's a lot of the same answers. So, along with James Merriam, I was appointed to the Newport City Council last March after some unexpected vacancies. And I've seen a lot of things grow and change over the past year. Sitting on the, from the perspective of being on the council, one of the things that I'm most proud of is creating a move toward transparency in our city government. One of the policies that has changed this year is that documents that will be examined at the next city council meeting are now made available to the public on the website, and that has never before happened. So the public can be more informed, and I think that's a huge win. After the 2 years ago unfortunate demise of the EB5 project and the hole, and we're all wondering, what are we going to do with the hole? Well, there's been a lot of scrambling, and now we're finally getting to the planning phase, and there's a lot of strategic planning going on. There were several feasibility studies that were funded by state agencies over the past year that have given us some direction and some new energy to figure out what we're going to do next, and some hope. And seeing hope be restored to this community is huge, and I think we're all revitalized somewhat. And the Renewport project with the Vermont Council on Rural Development, just the fact that we accepted their offer to host this community visit here, and then the wonderful turnout and the vigor that people have shown and the energy, I'm really excited for the next steps that'll happen next week. And I just hope to continue on with what we've started and make some real serious progress on our economic development and our public resources.
And John Wilson.
Well, you pretty well covered everything I have written down here. I guess I'd like to start with the hole. And in the past year, we've spent good money to get White and Burke to do studies and talk with people that can invest and then maybe come up with a solution on the hole. Along with that, we did allocate money to NCRC and our the downtown so that possibly they can hire an economic developer. Renewport, next week will be the third meeting we'll have had. The first two have been well attended. A lot of good ideas have come out from the public, and I think the one next week will be trying to put names against what areas people would like to work for. The centennial planning has been, I think, super. It's been ongoing, and now we're meeting every 2 weeks as we get closer. And with that, we've already improved along the causeway with flowers. The Newberry building, meetings were, that was supposed to have been developed maybe last year, but when the developer found out that there were tax credits to be had, he's backed off for a year, and hopefully things will start this summer for the Newberry building. Along with expanding our dispatch services, and it's going to become crucial. I attended a meeting this past week on reconciliation of our ambulance systems, because we're in a hurt money-wise across the county. So that will fit into the dispatch and trying to fix our ambulance systems.
All right. So that'll conclude the opening statement, or the question that is the same for all of the candidates. 2 minutes does go fast. Yep. You'll find that. I think a good key is if you keep your eye on Pam at about 30 seconds, she'll start hovering over the bell. And then at 30 seconds, you can start going down and she'll give it a ding. So we're going to go into, everybody's going to get a different question now. We're going to keep the same order. Because this is being broadcast live on the radio, I'm going to say everybody's name each time so the people listening at home will know who's speaking, and the people that are here will be able to put your face with your name. So by the end of the evening, we'll all know all of your names really, really well. However, I'm very bad with names, so if I see you tomorrow, I'll probably forget. So the first question will go back to Dan Ross. And the question is, a number of citizens are worried about the culture of intimidation and disrespect shown to citizens during city council meetings. How will you help to ensure that citizens' questions and comments are dealt with respectfully while maintaining an efficient and effective council process?
Regionally, we've had meetings with the Secretary of State, and he's gone over the open law. We have to maintain that. One of the most important things is public input. And if you go back to our Constitution and the article that's there, it talks about representatives working for the people. So if we're going to work for the people, we have to be available to listen. We have to be able to answer questions. We have to withstand comments that we don't like. And you can't take a comment you don't like and turn it into an argument. It makes no sense at all. And I think we have to have, and I think the mayor tried, but we have to have rules to operate the meeting by. And as it is now, the agenda will usually be take care of the minutes, whatever the next two items are, and it'll get the other business. I personally believe that you accept comments at any time. You don't have to wait to other business. But there's one other line item I think they should have, and they should have a question and answer period where you can regulate it a little better, and you're not slowing down the process by going back and forth. If anybody's been to any of the meetings, it doesn't matter what board it is in the city, we get rarely very many people there. And one of the things, if you want to open government, you've got to invite the people. You've got to make them welcome. You don't want them to show up and think, he's going to be after me again tonight. You know, it's that ability to welcome and listen. And we all have to have that ability.
And the next question will go to James Merriam. And as you'll see, my assistant here, Penny, is handing me questions. So she's testing my reading ability here. But if I stumble, ask me to repeat.
Okay.
So James Merriam, the vote on the proposed water tower appeared to be rushed in November, because the city council said they couldn't negotiate with the Derby Village Select Board. Would you be willing to negotiate with Derby and perhaps compromise in order to acquire the necessary water from Derby?
Wonderful. Thank you. This is a compelling question and a very relevant question, of course. And I would throw out there that this is something I also bring as a perspective from having lived in other parts of Vermont very recently, that the contrast between towns and the awareness of where one town begins and another town ends is much starker up here than in most places. And there is really, by intent or just by effect, a greater contrast in this area that is so generally downtrodden, that we have a lot of challenges that span across boundary lines, but the boundary lines end up being harder and more fast and more dividing than they are in other areas. Not that the rest of Vermont is doing great, not that the rest of Vermont is good at working together necessarily, not that anyone is necessarily good at working together, but that there are feelings of greater contrast and perhaps even greater animosity between municipalities around here. And we found ourselves, our local municipalities, in very different situations because of reasons of our own making and reasons of coincidence. And it's a big contrast between the financial and municipal situation from one side of the border to the other. So, I mean, we are all in this together, fundamentally. We cannot make Newport great by robbing Derby or the other way around. We are fundamentally in this together as a regional group, and we're going to need to be able to play nice in a broader sense. However, in this instance, the arrangement with Derby, buying water from Derby, was really never anything but a band-aid. And the water tower is a permanent, regional-wide area-wide solution to a big problem. Negotiating with Derby when they have a basically arbitrary billing cycle is all well and good, but we're thinking of long term here.
Right. Next question will be for Kevin Charbonneau. And that question is, how will you make Newport a more inclusive and cohesive community?
I made notes, I'm sorry, I'm just looking through them. I can't. Newport is already a cohesive community. There are perhaps citizens that are unhappy or disgruntled. But from what I witnessed in Newport in my years here, is that there are many energetic and capable volunteers organizing and putting into action various initiatives. And have not witnessed something that would suggest otherwise. The mayor has been forced to set some rules at city council meetings as the council tries to conduct Newport's business for the betterment of everybody and not allow the important issues to get derailed as some community members seek to create needless strife. So how to make Newport more inclusive will be starting at the public meetings and the city government. The members of Newport, I believe, work well together, and they all have the common goal of making Newport a better place.
Next question will be for, thank you, for Julie Raboy.
I think you meant women.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Uh-oh. See? Sorry. The next question would be for Woody Page. Sorry about that. Woody, your question is, how do you propose to make Newport City more pedestrian and bicycle friendly so tourists and residents will want to walk around downtown and shop locally?
Well, I think the first thing we need to do is slow down the traffic that goes through Newport. I think it goes way too fast through Newport as well as a number of our side streets. Maybe we need some sort of radar detection devices that are permanent, such as what Glover currently has, as well as Craftsbury Common. Another issue that I would like to see addressed is the large vehicles that come through our main street. They would rather come through Main Street because it's a shorter distance for them rather than taking, you know, the truck route through Coventry to their destination. And then I guess the third item I would like to address is the on Main Street would be to eliminate smoking and vaping from, say, the municipal building on down to the People's Bank. I think that would encourage pedestrians to sit outside some of the dining establishments in the summer, enjoy their coffee or dinner, and not have to smell somebody's secondhand smoke as they're sitting there. I think that would be a good thing, a positive thing for the downtown. And I think you could also probably incorporate it for the local parks as well.
All right, and now we'll move to Julie, and I apologize. I only mess up once an hour. A new hour starts in 5 minutes, though. Julie Raboyne, your question is, Newport has a number of recreational assets that are essential to the history and beauty of our city. What will you do to ensure that these assets are preserved and highlighted for residents and visiting tourists?
Sure. We do have a number of recreational assets, including some new ones, such as the Bluff Farm, where people are currently cross-country skiing and snowshoeing. And that's a great resource that's been added, where people can hike and go down to the lake and see all kinds of plants and wildlife. We have Garden Park that was built on probably not the best soil initially, but it is part of our recreational assets, and it has our ball fields and our playgrounds. And a number of years ago, there was a lot of fundraising going on to rebuild that playground. And I would like to see that effort revitalized and to have that playground be redone in a way that's safe and effective and a learning experience for children and a fun place to hang out. Our downtown area is right on the lake, and we have this wonderful boardwalk that we don't own. I would like to see the city consider taking ownership of that boardwalk and being able to add new things, maybe be able to rent some kayaks and canoes from there, and just consider options that have been thrown off the table for many years. We have so many wonderful natural resources, and we need to keep our lake clean. We need to be able to offer swimming lessons at a place where children are happy to go and get in the water. So between anything indoor and anything outdoor, we have all these wonderful seasons, being able to offer things to our residents first and also attract people from outside is really important.
All right, and the next question will be for John Wilson. John, what does transparency mean to you with regard to the operations of the Newport City Council?
What does transparency mean to me? Keeping the public informed of what we're doing. Occasionally we have executive session, but that's either for personnel problems, which the public doesn't need to know about, and or if we're have contracts, negotiation for contracts. For transparency, letting the public speak. There was an attempt to curtail public comment, and I did speak up and say you can't eliminate it. You don't want to eliminate it. One thing we did do was we always had it at the end of the meeting, public comments. Well, I think public comments shouldn't be at the end, because if one individual has a problem because a snow plow tore up his lawn, he may not want to wait for 2 hours for the regular meeting. So we moved it up front for public comments. Which I think has worked well. The other thing also would be, for transparency, we have the TV camera there for the regular meetings, and we pay them, so a little more incentive for them to show. They don't have to show for the off meetings, but sometimes they will. And, you know, the press is always there. We put it on the website now. So, yeah, I think we're as transparent as we can be. We're more transparent than the Vermont legislature is, because they are exempt from transparency laws.
All right. Real quick before the next question, just as in watching football on TV, we're going to take a quick second for station identification. So you are listening to this on WIKE, Newport, Vermont. Also is being filmed at NEK-TV, and it'll be on channel 15 with cable, Comcast cable. You're listening to the Newport City Council Candidate Forum. A number of candidates running for Newport City Council this year. March 6th is town meeting day. I forgot to mention that earlier. So we're learning about the candidates. The next candidate to speak will be Dan Ross. And your question, Dan, is, what are your thoughts on citizen engagement during city council meetings? Particularly, should attendance be allowed to ask questions throughout the duration of meetings rather than only at the beginning of meetings during public comments?
I guess this actually goes back to what I was talking about before. One of the problems is that we've had some, what I would call, I wouldn't call them controversial issues, but issues that involved a lot of people. And these people wanted their comments and their questions to be answered. Well, the important thing is all the council members are volunteers, and they're putting their time in, and they're trying to be polite, and they're trying to give everybody the opportunity. Now, it seemed to me, and I know all the members, one of the biggest problems was probably time constraints. You know, so when Paul went and decided that we're going to only allow this, this, and this, I personally felt it was too restrictive, that you still have to somehow give the time. You don't always have to comment back. And you don't always have to answer a question. Sometimes if you listen, you take in the comment. You listen, you take in the question. Or you might be able to say, I can't answer that question at this time. As long as you do it in a polite way. And not make people feel like you're stopping them. Right? I think people were felt like they were being stopped. And I think what we have to do is give them the sense that, yes, we are listening and we do care about what you want to say. And I serve on other boards, and that's my policy. I'm always going to listen. Will I always agree? No. Finally get to shut me up, huh?
Saved by the bell. and if the bell does ring and you can finish your sentence or your thought, you know, I didn't mention that before. We have had that happen in the past, though, where it just stopped like mid-word. You can let you finish the word. We're not too strict. The next question will be for James Merritt. And the question is, how will you demonstrate a commitment to revitalizing the Newport City downtown area?
Well, that's the whole question, isn't it? It's a fairly holistic approach. It's as what a number of things that have already been addressed, taking angles to take advantage of our recreational opportunities, which are tremendous and myriad. Supporting business coming in, new businesses coming in, and especially supporting businesses that are already present. I've heard that called gardening your businesses rather than hunting for new ones. But to be avid gardeners and regular hunters as well, I think is a big part of it. Of course, making things more pedestrian and bike friendly, such that the residents of Newport can enjoy their downtown to a greater extent, as it is in such a beautiful part of the world. That's that would certainly be a very large part of it. I mean, really, the chosen topics for Re Newport are all very central to this particular angle, and I think we're also there are very much priorities for Re Newport and for the council going forward. In terms of new projects, we, of course, one of those very controversial topics that we discussed was bringing snowmobiles into downtown, and having permanent, like, comprehensive and well thought out routes for snowmobiles and ATV traffic, preferably separate from car traffic and pedestrian traffic, and similarly access for cross-country skiers and bikers, because especially Quebecois are inclined to go on those long bike trips and those long ski trips, and that's just a wonderful opportunity and something that to not have to stop at the border, to be able to continue those into our beautiful lakes and mountains is such an opportunity that we are so close to being able to take advantage of. So a comprehensive, from the beginning, not ad hoc, not one meeting for one trail, but thinking about this in terms of the whole city transport plan in the long term.
Next question will go to Kevin Charbonneau. And that question is, access to high quality, affordable childcare has been identified as an essential need for working families. What do you plan to do as a city council member to support citizens' access to this vital resource?
It's not within the city council's authority to regulate childcare and provide access to it. This is, however, a topic that is being addressed by the Council on Rural Development. And there's a meeting on February 21st at 6:30 p.m. at the Career Center. There are also agencies from the state that regulate this. And a simple Google search can pull that up through the Department of Children and Families, DCF. They have links there to help somebody access it, licensing, and a whole myriad of topics around this. But unfortunately, the City Council is not within their authority statutorily to address this issue.
Next question will be for Woody. Woody Page. Your question is, education is a significant key in breaking the cycle of poverty. At a time when educators do not feel supported at the state legislature level, how will you support and lift up the community members whose livelihood is teaching?
Well, I think we all realize how important teachers are and education is today. Teachers have a very difficult job to do. It's probably one of the most difficult jobs, next to maybe law enforcement or the military. It's an important job that they have looking after our children. And as we can see in the recent issue in Florida, in many cases, not only do they teach our children, but they also protect our children. So they play a very big role in our life. When I was in the military, and I had moved quite a bit during my service, whenever we would move to a new location, the first thing we would ask is, how are the schools? And that was the most important thing, to get our children into the best schools so that they would have a good education. And for Newport, that's a very important thing. We need a good continuing improvement in our educational system here. If we don't have a good education system, then we're not going to be able to attract people to the area. We're not going to be able to attract companies to the area. So I think that's a very important issue that needs some attention. Thank you.
Julie Rapoin will have the next question. And Julie, the question is, how will you ensure that a city government, let me read that again because I missed that. How will you ensure that city government officials are making decisions that are in the best interest of the community, particularly if said individuals are not residing members of the Newport City community?
That's been a hot topic over the past few years. In my work as a community organizer in public health and in previous jobs in nonprofit, I tend to have worked in regional areas, not for a municipality, but where we're serving an entire county, or all of Orleans County and Essex North, which is Canaan and Island Pond. So working in that environment, obviously you're not living in each of those communities, and I've seen wonderful work happen outside of people's home communities. I think it is much easier to serve and be interested and passionate about the community that you do live in, but I don't think it's out of the question to be able to care and make really wise decisions about communities where you're not necessarily a taxpayer. I think the most important thing in ensuring that our city officials are making decisions that are in the best interest of our community is that it's a joint decision-making process, that the decision-making process is transparent, that the entire city council gets to give their input on each issue, and that decisions are not being made behind closed doors, and there are not backroom deals. We need more transparency, and that will ensure that we have good decisions.
And the next question is for John Wilson. John, do you feel that decisions on important and expensive issues have been rushed? What role should the council members have in both the timing and informing the public of these issues?
It's a tough question. I think recently the most expensive issue has been the water tower. Even though we have had two or three different councils working on it for maybe 6 years, when that one came about, it was rushed. We wanted to get it in when there was an actual vote going on. Timing was not good. Not only did everybody and I have all the answers, to ask the taxpayers to fund another bond when we had just received our new property reevaluations. And I know three of us have come off since September on appeals. The timing was poor. I said the timing was poor, but they put it out to vote anyways. We have a little bit more time. We have more answers now. Before, we couldn't even tell them, you know, there wasn't a new park. We're working on a piece of property in Newport, but there are times when, yes, stuff was rushed, and the taxpayers and the voters let us know it was rushed. So we go back, do our homework, and hopefully we'll put it back out. Hopefully we'll have more than 500 people show up for a vote. And we'll go from there. But yes, there are times when big ticket items, the council does not try to do that, though. We try to work it out, have public meetings, poorly attended as a rule, and then put it out for vote.
The next question will go back to Dan Ross. Dan, how will you promote programs, ideas, and resources that focus on retaining young working professionals so that they can become active and productive members of our workforce and community?
I'm going to get all the hired ones.
It's like the lottery.
You know, I work with a young man at the Career Center. He's probably 26. He went to VTC and he got a degree in civil engineering. And of course, he couldn't find a job in the kingdom. So he went to the middle part of the state and worked for a small engineering firm. And an opportunity came up for a teaching position at the Career Center. And that brought him back to Newport. It is about jobs, and it's about getting companies to the area that have jobs that will support these young people in a way where they can live a standard that, and that's true for anybody, you know. So one of the big things is we do have to provide the jobs. We have to develop our community so companies would want to move here. We have to look at regional business, because Newport doesn't have a lot of area to build businesses. Manufacturing usually has better paying jobs. One of the companies in St. Johnsbury was looking for a place to go. Newport didn't have it. They went to New Hampshire. They did a job search in St. Johnsbury and had 7 people show up. When they went to New Hampshire, they had over 300. You know, the people were hungry for a job. We need more job training opportunities, and we need jobs for those skills that we're training our people to do. And it doesn't matter at what age they are. And we do have the educational facilities. We have the Career Center, which teaches some good skills. We have regional colleges. I mean, we're not that far from UVM, VTC, Middlebury. Education and jobs.
Next question is for James Merriam. James, many residents do not see the current proposed property tax rate as sustainable. What will you do to alleviate this burden?
I mean, that's a big question, and that's a big question that we, of course, are perhaps waiting for big news out of the state that could completely change the equation. And we'd be going back to the drawing board on what to do with Newport in particular. But on a fundamental level, I guess the question to every Newport resident is, do you feel you are getting what you paid for? Because again, I lived in Montpelier for many years, and there was an uproar every few years for the appraisal, and every year when tax bills came out, that Montpelier was way overtaxed. In particular, the same sort of statistics came out that Montpelier was so far out of whack. But we had a lot of quality services. And let me tell you, for a city half the size, Newport does honestly better than Montpelier does in a lot of departments. So if we want to have, we're doing things that most municipalities don't. We have a better quality of service than most municipalities, and I am blown away by our municipal employees. But it means putting those quality people out of work. And that would save everybody's tax burden. That would cut back on property taxes. I mean, the state is looking for a more fair way to do things, to have things doled out more evenly. And I mean, the folks that came in to contest their taxes did not tend to be the people who were scraping by trying to just make through a little bit. It was disproportionately out of state or non-resident, wealthier folks. So it's what constitutes a fair share for all the different people from all the different walks of life who participate in this community? And what do we want to be as a community? To both attract, as the last question was, to both attract and retain young, well, not only young professionals, but young blue-collar workers as well. People who need to lean on the broader community a little bit just for a leg up. Really, community events and things that buoy our spirits are just as much a social safety net as things for the as things that, that feed us and that kind of thing.
All right. Before I ask the so we've gone through pretty quick. We're down to the last question, which means we are not yet, but we're going to be taking some open questions. The next one in line is Kevin, correct?
Yes.
So what I think we should do is maybe shuffle through these questions so everybody answers mm-hmm. one more question that they haven't answered. And then once we get through that, we'll take questions from the floor. So if you'd like to ask a question, we're going to ask you to line up kind of on, yeah, by near-ish the podium, similar to the legislative breakfast. And we'll just go first come, first serve. Don't trample over each other. No fighting. And we'll take some questions from the floor. But before we do that, we'll go through one more question for each candidate. And we are on Kevin, correct?
Yeah.
See how easily I get confused? I lose track of things like that. Kevin, the question is, according to the 2012 to 2016 American Community Survey estimate, 22.2% of Newport City residents are living below the poverty line. How will you support these vulnerable community members?
We want to encourage business employers to locate here. One possible way the council can help this is the use of the tax stabilization program whenever it's possible to apply it. We should continue to foster and support the city economic development initiatives to fill the Main Street and the former Bogner site. I would also encourage the development initiatives of the Bluffside Farm so that aligns with the government's Vermont Outdoor Recreation Economic Collaboration, VORAC. And there is an entire website on VORAC and what they can do to assist various communities. The city of Newport also, each election year, votes on monetary allocations which support numerous local agencies, such as NECA, Youth Services, Umbrella. These agencies provide a valuable resource to the vulnerable community. And perhaps the single biggest support that the city council can do is to fully support and fund our city departments. Our department heads are looking at ways to benefit the Newport residents. One example is the countywide dispatch. Will not only provide local jobs, but local control and a better service for residents when an emergency occurs.
All right, and...
Okay.
Next question will be for Woody. Woody Page, and this question has already been asked, but not to you, I hope.
She'll see.
If it's the exact one that you already answered, let me know. Many residents do not see the current proposed property tax rate as sustainable. What would you do to alleviate this burden?
Well, as James Merriman already discussed this issue, as a property owner, I have some concerns as well. Newport has one of the highest tax rates in the state. So the question probably should be asked, what services are you willing to cut? And I don't think any of us are willing to cut the services that we receive here. I think we have a great number of services from the Public Works Department that does, you know, the plowing and looking after our streets, the water. We have great water, the emergency services, whenever you contact the police department, they respond quickly. The emergency, the medical services, the hospital, all those things are primarily one of the reasons why I think we all live here in Newport. If you live out in the outskirts of Newport, way out in the hinterlands, you don't have a lot of those services that currently have here. And that's one of the attractions for us to live in Newport. It's also an attraction in which companies are willing to locate here. you asked what we might do to alleviate the problem. I think one of the issues would be, look at how we're spending our money. One such issue that has come up was the $75,000 which we allocated for the study of a water tower. To me, that seems too much. I think we should be a lot smarter in how we spend our money. I think we should have paid maybe a quarter of that. But I don't know all of the details on that. That's just my own primary opinion.
Next question will be for Julie Reborn. Julie, how will you demonstrate a commitment to revitalizing the Newport City downtown area?
A couple of years ago, I worked as a part-time programs coordinator for Newport City Renaissance Corporation until I was laid off. And that gave me a very in-depth and unique perspective on what's happening downtown, what the downtown designation program is about, and what exactly we can do to revitalize Newport City. One of the things I think that we can do right off the bat is listen to the recommendations that we've gotten from those consultants that we've paid so much money to. One of the recommendations from the White and Burke Report was to welcome events downtown, host events, have recreation activities and races and parades. And for some reason, not everybody in our city administration believes that that will help economic development. And it's kind of crazy because when we bring people downtown, they get the flavor of how great it is to be part of a community. And when we frequent those businesses are successful and can employ people, and employed people can buy houses. And when people buy houses, they're paying property taxes. So it's this wonderful system that builds upon itself, but you have to start by believing in the things that have proven to make a downtown successful. So we need to listen to the recommendations we've already gotten. We need to make it easier to host events downtown. We need to make sure our Newport City, our Renaissance Corporation is staffed and that they're doing the work that they are supposed to be doing. And we need to pay attention to the built environment, make sure it's walkable, bikeable. We have benches downtown so that it looks appealing and people want to come downtown and spend time there and spend their money there. And one other thing that goes very closely along with that is our recreation programs. Some of our resources for children have been caught lately, where there's no longer some out-of-school programming. And we need to make sure that parents have access so they can come downtown and support their children in those activities and be part of our city.
Next question is for John Wilson. Newport has a number of recreational assets that are essential to the history and beauty of the city. What will you do to ensure that these assets are preserved and highlighted for residents and visiting tourists?
I think we've already gone forward in this aspect. The upgrades in the causeway, the flower pots, we've had to fix some of the islands so trucks can go around and not run over the islands and our signs. We work with putting the flower pots throughout the city, and they do add a lot of beauty to downtown. We've just added the waterfront walkway over by behind Vista, and that will hook in eventually to all the walking trails that we have. A couple of heated meetings on allowing skidoos into the city. We have now allowed them into a certain portion, and if that works well, we'll expand that into downtown. I got to talk with the individual that's from VAST, and he said that he ran into one of the individuals that was really against the skidoos in the area. She was out on that street skiing, and she said it's worked out real well. All the horrors that she thought, so that's going forward. Next year, we may cover part of the bridge and allow them into Pomelo Park, where they're not going to be driving up down Main Street, but so we're moving forward in that way. The last couple of years, we've slowly started removing the weeds and cutting, making the water more accessible to people. Monday night, there'll be a open meeting on expanding over to Land Trust on the Scott Farm for more trails there. So we're working forward to make the downtown a lot more accessible.
All right, so that concludes the pre-submitted questions. So if anybody does have questions from the floor, we'll kind of go in order. You can just line up over by Bruce, I guess. And we'll take them if possible. I don't know.
What's that one?
Bruce, if I hand this microphone, will that work and I can use this one?
I think it will.
All right, so I'm going to. I turned it off. Yeah.
Should it be on?
We just want to make sure it doesn't feed back with the speaker.
I don't really need one.
Well, if we get to
see on the radio.
Over here.
Okay.
We'll need you on the radio.
Okay.
If possible, you can direct questions to a specific candidate, or I think we actually have a good amount of time. So if you want each candidate to answer, but we'll try to limit it to one minute. So.
Okay.
Because we do have a final question for the last 15 minutes or so for all the candidates.
Super. So guys, the other day my wife got the cleaning bug that she gets every now and then. She dug up my old yearbook. I'm proud to say that I'm a 1975 graduate of North Country Union High School. And we looked at the sponsors that sponsored that yearbook. And 75% of those sponsors no longer exist in our community. So I really think that we're definitely on a non-sustainable course with our spending and our taxation. Not that we're frugal in our spending or extravagant in our spending in any way, be it education or city services, but I mean the simple numbers speak for themselves. There's not enough of us to pay for those services. And going forward, I'm really afraid that we're going to end up with a two-class system in our city. There'll be the rich and those dependent on the rich to live here. And the reason I told you the story is this. Instead of threatening the citizens of the city with cutting services to reduce taxes, I think we need to look at a regional approach and sharing regional services. Pastor Marion said it well, that there definitely is a divide between us and our neighbors to the north, Derby. We need to find ways to break down that divide. We need to start sharing our public safety. We spend millions of dollars on our police department that could easily be ramped up by another car and maybe two officers, and we could cover both Derby and Newport, and perhaps cut that cost right in half. We're looking at our dispatching, which I'm proud of. We've got a lot of that equipment in there when I was on the council. We need to start sharing that. We need to start doing a regional fire department. So I think that's probably the approach that we're going to need to take to be sustainable in our city and still maintain our departments. So I guess the question that I have for you all, and you can address it, whoever wants to address it, is how are you going to approach or make amends with Derby? I think with Grant Spates as the chair, I think there's somebody workable up there that we could get a dialogue going and start sharing those services, because I really see that as the only way that we're going to survive.
I think we'll just keep the same order, let each of you address it. Do you want to do a minute response? So we'll try to keep our responses to a minute so we can get as many questions as possible. So for our listeners on the radio, Dan Ross is the first one to speak.
I think Steve made an incredible point. And I think the ambulance service, the regional ambulance service, shows what can happen if you don't start working together. And you have several facilities doing the same thing. And then the cost, none of them can really cover it, and it starts to collapse. And now they have to move to a regional system. Derby does need police protection. I don't think there'd be anything wrong. I don't know how they would do it. My own preference would be that we have facilities in Newport and facilities in Derby, so they're not running from Newport to Derby and Derby to Newport. I think that can be done.
As far as water, one of the biggest problems with water is that, and I'll be honest, I voted against it. I have my reasons. But I think it would have passed if it had presented it in a better manner. One of the things with water, and the people in the city don't realize, your fire protection and your household insurance is based on that response time and stuff. If we do not have adequate water for fire protection, you may find that your homeowner's insurance will go up. So we really have to come to a settlement on what we're going to do with water, whether it's with Derby or the tower. But I think as things change, other people can get together and make decisions and come to compromise.
James Merriam?
While no one likes to see old businesses go away, and we have some very, very wonderful, very, very long-term businesses, I mean, I don't know if you'd find a better ratio in many other communities or really at any other time. I mean, times change, new technologies come up, new fads come along that need to be, and those who don't adapt as people say, the time has come, just time is up. And it was with a number of the businesses that recently closed in Newport, time was up. And with a number of the businesses that recently opened, it was, now is our time. Times do change, and every era has had a challenge. There's no point in looking at things with rose-colored glasses. Derby has made a number of choices about their municipal services, and I agree also that not only with Grant, but also with Karen Sutomber coming into the select board, but we need to understand that Derby itself is to some extent at cross purposes, because they're two villages and the town, three different municipalities, all with their own priorities and all with their own history and significance. So it's not like it's just a couple of people's old grudge that keeps this from working. And these are, both of us are big areas with our own needs and our own particular things. So what we can do best to ourselves is our choice, and though it affects one another, this is what we do and what we choose to do.
Kevin Sharma.
I think you hit the nail on the head when you were talking about regional dispatch and regional emergency services. Currently, Derby is covered by the state police and the sheriff's department. I know that the state police in particular are also facing budget problems without a substantial increase in manpower. Walmart has proved to be a drain on resources, and so they have limited the amount of cases that will be taken from Walmart. It will be not too long before Derby realizes that they are going to be in need of a police department or police services. Currently, our chief of police is coordinating the regional dispatch and building the infrastructure not only for Newport and the surrounding towns, but something that, you know, Derby will be able to take part of as well.
Woody Page.
I think Mr. Vinson is right. We are fast approaching a two-class system. Those that can afford to live in Newport and afford property taxes, and those that rent. I would also say that some of the services that we provide, I think we're already cooperating with other towns, such as our fire department that responds to various locations when it's called upon. Our police department also, I've seen, respond to issues on the Derby Road. So some of that may already be happening. We may not be, we're probably not being reimbursed for some of that work that we're doing, but I believe we're already moving towards that. The other issue I have concern with combining forces, at some point or another, you're still going to have the problem of being able to afford those services, because you know you'll have a larger area to cover, and You know, you're still going to probably, our taxes are never going to go down, is what I'm trying to say. No matter whether we combine our forces or not, you know.
That's not a very good way to do a poll.
Well, no, but sometimes truth hurts.
Julie Reboin is next.
I'm going to be brief because it's difficult to answer the same question when you're at this end of the line, and I would suggest that for the next question, we might reverse order.
I almost did that.
Well, you still have a chance.
We'll do that the next time, yes. Good idea.
So many states have a county government system that we don't have in Vermont, and working toward this regionalized system of ambulance care, and we have a regional hospital, and our regional state services are all by county and or county and a half, I think it makes perfect sense to consider combining more forces. A police force of the size that we have for just Newport City, I think it's definitely worth considering expanding that reach and sharing the cost with another municipality. The same with many other services. And you know, there's talk of joining towns and making Derby and Newport one unit. And I wouldn't rule that out. I don't know all the ins and outs of it, but it's something I'm more than willing to consider.
And John Wilson is next.
Yeah, I think I can be quick. 25% of Newport is non-taxable. So we really feel a pinch of having all the services right here in Newport. But that's why one of the reasons our taxes are so high. Regionalization and combining is a great idea. But just the police department alone, that's been suggested before. Derby's paying roughly $60,000 a year for police protection through the sheriff. We're paying over $1 million for our police department. If you were a taxpayer in Derby, I don't think you'd vote too much in favor of consolidation if you're going to see your taxes go up maybe $500,000. But it doesn't hurt to work forward in this and ask. The one on the ambulance was a great meeting. We had just about everybody from this region on ambulances. Suggestion was that it's a county dispatch. Bring a side judge on board to be on the committee. Great idea, and then he can bill it out services once they figure out where they should be over the 11 towns in the county. Problem, to do that, we need the legislature to approve that. So, but if we force enough, maybe we can get our legislatures to bring it in. But the problem down there is, we're working on a rural area, and then you have cities like Burlington, they're not rural, they're very urban. So they're not too overly wanting to help us. But we'll keep working at it.
We'll take another question, and we will go back down the other way. That was a good idea. I know one time I tried to stagger them all, so it was one, and that was way too confusing. So this question will start with John, and we'll go back down this way.
I'll make this one simple.
You have the floor.
My name is Jack Robert. I obviously live in Newport. I'm going to make this real simple. My question is actually addressed to only one person.
Okay.
I sent this question in, but apparently they didn't feel it was worth asking. Now, my question is to Mr. Wilson. You are the longest serving member of the council in the history of Newport. My question to you is, why would people want to, what have you accomplished to want to, for the people to send you for another 2 years over all the many years that you've been on? Give us a good reason why we should send you for another 2 years.
I would say there's many reasons. First of all, I have the experience. Number two, I care about Newport. I am open to listen to people. Everywhere I go in town, if I'm asked a question, you can ask my wife, she sits in the car while I talk to people. But she never complains. And I will always get you back an answer. I'm still young enough where I've got a couple more good years left in me. And I think I've taken care of, especially a lot of the elderly people in town that live on a fixed income. So I think that's the reason that I should, people should vote for me for another 2 years.
That was a question for just one candidate, so...
Are you waiting to ask
me
a question?
We have one. While we wait for the next question, I'll just... if you're listening on WIKE or listening to the Newport City Council Candidates Forum, and it's being held live here at the Goodrich Memorial Library in Newport, Vermont, and it's being filmed for NEKTV, Channel 15. There are more questions.
Sure, I'll step up with another question from the radio station, more or less. And that is, how important is the Welcome Center in downtown Newport? Right now, the staffing is a problem. The Rotary Club is saying that they would be interested in coming up with a plan, working with the city and with the chamber. How do you feel about that? Should the city get involved in that to help make that Welcome Center be full time or as often as it can be?
And even though John did just answer, we'll still go back this way or that way. So I'll allow John to go again. Because I'm the moderator, right? And then we'll work our way. Then we'll work our way down. So John, you can take the first stab at that.
Yes, I know the chamber is having a hard time finding personnel to man the building. It provides a good service when people come into town. That's one of the first places they go. Just hearing nothing has been presented to us, but yes, I've heard that the Rotary is interested in using their volunteers to help man the building. One of the problems is who's going to pay for the sewer, the water, and the electricity that are in that building. They will provide the personnel, but I don't think they want to pay for the bills. So does the city get involved? I believe it's set up where if they disappeared, we'd have to take the building back. So. Yes, once I think the Rotary presents their plan to us, then as a council we'll have to decide whether we want to pay for the water, sewer. I mean, we already keep it plowed and stuff like that. So.
And that's my question, guys, is how important is that to you, to get involved or not get involved?
Oh, it is important. I mean, tourists come into town, the first place they normally stop is at the Chamber of Commerce, finding out what's going on and what's available in town. So anything that will keep people in town spending money and enjoying what we have to offer is very important, yes.
Julie, same question. Mm-hmm.
At the end of 2015, something very strange happened in Newport. Newport City Renaissance Corporation and the Vermont Small Country Chamber of Commerce both almost collapsed simultaneously. I'm not sure exactly what was behind that, but I believe it was part volunteerism or lack thereof, lack of funding. But it was a very unfortunate time that two of the very important organizations that were to bring tourists to town and welcome people and participate in economic development were no longer there. I think it's really important to have a vibrant Chamber of Commerce and a building for people to land at. The last time I heard about somebody going to the Chamber of Commerce, they reported that the hours were all day on Monday, but maybe half a day, 3 or 4 other days a week. Well, who's traveling on a Monday that needs the Chamber of Commerce? And maybe that's just because volunteer power was available on Monday, but we need to have volunteerism in ways that work for people and work for bringing in tourists. I think it is the city's job to make sure that things are well-oiled, well-greased, and things are functioning properly when those things are going to greatly affect economic development and the businesses that we already have in place. I think it's our job as city leaders to support any of our organizations that are struggling and make sure that they're set on track to get self-sufficient. And if that means paying for the water and sewer for a time, maybe even contributing staff time for a bit, I think that's perfectly reasonable.
Woody Page is next.
When you first enter Vermont,
There's a welcome center just outside Brattleboro, and most people stop there. That's their very first stop in Vermont. It gives them a wealth of information. The same applies to Newport. When you come down the interstate, you see that building. It's a very lovely building, well constructed, well taken care of. That building should be manned. I don't know how the city should do it, but we should do it, whether it's partially with volunteer help or with part-time help.
Kevin Sharp, same question.
As it's been stated before, that is an important asset to the city of Newport. And relying on volunteers is well and good, except that you run into issues as we have of reduced hours and such. Perhaps, you know, a study or research can go into this. One thing that comes off the top of my head, it's a new building. We have a recreation department. It's right by the park. What a great place for an office. Have visitors, they come in. Everything they need is right there. But that, again, that's just a random idea. There can be a lot of other possibilities to make this happen.
James Merriam is next.
Well, sure. I mean, it's certainly an opportunity, but I think the use of the Welcome Center would need to be part of maybe a more comprehensive plan for that whole area of town. Since that area of town already is I mean, literally and figuratively a bridge, but leaves the Welcome Center really on an island with water around half of it and asphalt around the rest and cars going really, really fast. I mean, you have to notice it and stop really quick if you're driving, and if you're trying to walk there, you're basically out of luck, or bike there. So these opportunities are really on a fast road that's just off the state highway. I mean, and looks like a state highway. You might as well be going. It looks like it's a 55-mile-an-hour road, and it looks like an island. It looks like the kind of thing that's abandoned in towns all over the country. So. I think there's some appearance issues, there's some welcoming aspects to the Welcome Center that could be worked on. And I mean, this is a part of a broader issue. Just the very fact that our downtown designation does not include East Main Street, and I have been informed it can't include East Main Street because the two parts really aren't connected in any real way. And the Welcome Center has the opportunity, but it would take a lot of work and a lot of comprehensive work to be a node as part of the connection between the two sides of a split down the middle community.
And Dan Ross.
I was actually there when they built the facility with some of my students and Tom Rooney. Reg Alexander, who I adore, volunteered there. I think he's 92 now. I don't know if he's still volunteering. The facility does have a history in Newport. Do I feel that the city could fund the sewer and water? I can't believe it would be that expensive for that facility. It's but in order to bring it back, you've got to bring business back so that they can join the chamber. I mean, the chamber does not exist without business. So, can we reconfigure it so it does something else, like the rec office or something, and they take care of people that occasionally drop in? I think it would be a shame to lose it, and then we have to keep it in some form.
All right. I think we have time for a couple more, two more questions for everybody, and you know, but if it's just for one person, you can get a couple more.
Okay,
I'm just going to play with time.
Okay, I actually have one for each of them.
Okay, perfect.
Well, same question.
Okay, yes.
now that the EB5 debacle has been resolved and the contractors have been made whole again, and apparently the investors are going to get their money back. JP is thriving. It's marketable. Burke looks like it's thriving and is marketable. And Newport is stuck with a hole in the ground and an empty Bogner building. You knew this question was going to come up. So my question to you all is,
What do you see as the city's role in either developing or moving forward with these? And what are your own personal ideas to develop both properties, the hole in the ground and the bunker property?
And we'll start back down with Dan Ross again and work our way back this way.
Yes, Tom.
Let's start with the hole in the ground. Again, it goes back to where you're going to find a developer that wants to build out on that property wall to wall and spend $20 million. Who doesn't want to see him getting his money back? You know, you're not going to, nobody's going to build there unless they have a return. That's what business is about. My personal thing is that I wish the city had it and they could subdivide it into five lots. And if it took 25 years and one building was built every 5 years to bring the city back. There's a hole in St. John's where it's been there for probably 27 years now. And nobody's ever approached that hole. And I think the same reason is there, the hole is so big that nobody can see a return on their money. Now, as far as Bogner, God, it's like the forgotten hole, okay? And there is a significant difference between the two. Bogner was EB-5. The hole was Curios's personal money. So however the receiver decides to kick it out, I think as a group, as a community, we have to look at how he's going to kick it out and what we can do to make sure it's something that's viable for the city.
James Merrick.
Well, a lot of good points made, and I know we'll probably be repeating each other quite a bit. I definitely agree that cities are made of little of people doing their little bit side by side and building up together. So thinking of any expectation that one sort of angel investor or that we can expect, I know it's my line of work, but I don't count on a savior to come in to fix the hole in the ground, and that dividing it into a bunch of little pieces and working as we go, because it's a long haul kind of a thing. And I mean, I've lived in Montpelier where there was a relatively small hole for years and years and years, and basically people got fed up and made a park, and it's been a huge success. And of course, admittedly, that's a much smaller percentage of the Newport downtown, but you just have to, there's a time comes when it just needs to be something. And we're not there yet, but I hope that at least this means some progress will be made. And that we will perhaps hope, but give up the expectation that we'll have a savior to come in like this. Bogner, of course, has the challenge of its level of pollution. That's a huge expense and a huge challenge, though it has the side expectation of EV5. So I just don't know. Perhaps it has recreational opportunities, since it is such a large and such a beautiful spot way up on the hill overlooking our beautiful lake.
And Kevin Sharp?
I don't think the city of Newport should be in the business of buying property and trying to develop it. What we can do to make it more attractive to investors and entrepreneurs is to make our community attractive. Have things that will draw people here, events, festivals. Let me use for an example. Last summer, a couple residents put together the concert series on a waterfront. And if anybody was fortunate enough to go, they saw that Lagos, Belvedere, the Tasting Center were filled those nights. The waterfront was filled with people enjoying themselves and walking around Newport. When you have something like that, when you have festivals like that or events that draw people in, they're more apt to spend their money locally, and when that business person sees that, they realize they can capitalize on those people and they'll build a business. I'm no businessman, but I don't think you can build something and just hope that people will show up.
Woody Page is next.
I agree with Mr. Charbonneau. The city should not purchase that property. We are not St. Albans. I know there's been a lot of talk about the success that St. Albans has had in purchasing property and developing it. But I agree, I do not think we should be in the business of developing property. And we're not a bedroom community to a large area like Burlington. But that property does have to be developed one way or another. And I think the Renaissance Corporation is a good step. I had mentioned earlier, $60,000 for a salary to hire a director that will help with that. I frankly don't think $60,000 is enough to get the right person to help with the development of that property. You're going to need somebody that has experience dealing with this type of situation in the past. A person that knows how to deal with legal ramifications, that knows how to deal with receiverships. Individuals that have connections with businesses, business people. Individuals that have connections with government, federal and state individuals that can help us get the tax incentives to help to get that property developed. And as far as seeing what I would like to see in it, probably something on the basis of what Mr. Stenger's vision was for that property originally.
Julie Reboy is next.
I think there's a number of strategies that we can implement. I think we need to preserve our form-based code zoning model to ensure that the street view is attractive and will be usable to a number of different sectors of our community. Usually it's business or restaurant on the ground floor, business offices on the second floor, maybe the third floor, fourth floor, high-end residences. I think that's a great model to continue to pursue. I hate to keep going back to the White and Burke consultants that were hired to do some visibility studies, but one of the things that they suggested is that the assessment on the whole was way too high. And because of that suggestion, the Historic Preservation stepped forth with some funding to purchase a new assessment. And I don't know the results of that yet, but the expectation is that it will be valued at a far more affordable price where a developer might actually consider buying it and developing it. I think the city's role in that is to, as Mr. Page said, have that Newport City Renaissance Corporation economic development person work really hard to make this happen and scare up some developers that might have ideas and to implement some creative ideas. Whether we use the St. Albans model or not, we need to encourage some of our development organizations like NVDA and NCIC to get together and support this venture to make sure that something is developed sooner rather than later.
And John Wilson.
That's tough. The Bogner property is really out of our hands right now because it's still under the EB-5 program. The only thing we can have much input in is the hall itself. And hopefully he'll want to dump that and sell it. I don't think we're going to find it. The city can't afford to buy it. I mean, we just come in and say we need another $2 million to buy the hall. Well, people will be screaming big time. We don't have the money. But by hiring an economic developer and grants through NCRC and grants were found through NVDA, and it doesn't have to sell as one big package. Last I heard that they were talking three packages. But that's all up to the receiver right now as to how he wants to dispose of that property. But we, as a city, we shouldn't be buying property like that. It's hard to buy when you don't have any money to start with.
All right. So looking at the time, we'll go to the final question. So I want to thank everybody that asked a question from the floor, and now I get to ask the final question. Who did we start with last time? John. So we'll start back down with Dan. See, I get confused.
You just did.
All the time.
We started down here last night.
So we're going to start with John and we're going to go down here. Okay.
We can zigzag.
I have to.
Okay.
We could zigzag, but I don't know if I can.
I'll help you. Why don't we start with Woody and work up this way and then we'll go back down.
Okay. All right. We'll zigzag.
Thank you.
So one final question, and then I'll do our final thank yous. And each person running for the city council will get the same question. And the question is, and if at any point you need me to repeat it, just ask. Please describe, and this is your closing remarks too. It's 2 minutes as before, and the bell will toll at 2 minutes. Please describe your vision for the city of Newport and how your election to the city council will help to achieve this vision.
And Woody.
We're starting with Woody Page.
Okay, thank you. I think it was Yogi Berra who said, the future isn't what it used to be, and I hope that our future here is better than we ever could have imagined. And these are some of the things that I would like to focus on. Again, jobs. We need jobs here. We need to keep the ones that we currently have, and we have to attract others. Bogner was mentioned earlier. That's a beautiful place for a company headquarters. We should try to focus on that as well. Continued improvement on our schools. If we don't have good schools, we're not going to attract any companies or any families here to the area. We should also help and support a child care center, a daycare center. I think that would be great for working families. It's been done recently in East Craftsbury with the local church. Some of our local churches may be working on that very issue. Again, marketing and advertising Newport to attract people to our area. Tax incentives. Our governor has been talking about how do we attract people to Vermont. We have the same issue. How do we attract people to Newport? We have a beautiful scenery, beautiful lake here. We have the same problem. But I believe that if we have to give tax incentives to people that will move here with their families, that will locate in Newport, buy a home, there has to be some sort of tax incentive for them to move here. First-class recreational area. We have a great park here. We've let it go over the past few years. A couple of years ago, there was some support for grant money for the grandstand, and we let it go. It's probably beyond repair now. But there's no reason why we shouldn't have a grandstand there. Take a look at Montpelier's grandstand that they have where they host the Vermont Mountaineers. We've talked about this, and you see some great baseball there, and there's no reason why we couldn't have a great collegiate baseball team here playing over in the recreational area, in the grandstand there.
The bell did ring.
Yes, I
am. Unfortunately, we're going to have to cut you off.
I have some more ideas. I'll be willing to talk to you after.
I was going to say, I did want to mention that feel free to mingle after and ask any of the candidates. I hope I'm not speaking for you guys, but ask any of the candidates any questions that you have and get to know them. There's candy to eat, so that's dinner. Julie's next. Okay, so same question. Julie Raboyne is the next candidate to speak.
I am happy to hang around after, but you know what? It's a lot more tiring up here than you might expect. It is getting close to my bedtime as well. One of my favorite sayings is that a rising tide lifts all boats. And our tide is finally rising again in Newport. And how do we keep our tide rising? We plan ahead. I think a serious lack of planning has gone on in Newport City for a long time. Strategic planning, 5-year plans, 10-year plans, envisioning the future, what you want it to look like, and then making a plan to get there is so important. If you don't know where you're going, then you're not going to get there, right? I think it's really important as we plan to have our basic structure of city government functional. We need to support community. without the people in a community, we don't have a city. As leaders of the city, we are servants, public servants, and I think to instill that belief through all of our city administration is so crucial for us to get anywhere. We need to instill trust. We need to believe that we're all working together for the greater good. We need to make sure that all community members have access to the things that they need to be healthy. We need to make sure that there are opportunities for kids and grown-ups and families to come together and have social connection, because that's what makes communities work, when neighbors are there for each other. The 99 Center is a perfect example of how wonderful community can be to support each other. It doesn't necessarily take more money, more tax money. It takes a different attitude, a different approach, a level of trust that we haven't seen before. And I want to foster that. I want to work on that, continue to work on that, and I hope that you'll vote for me and allow me to achieve that.
John.
And John Wilson is the next candidate.
Vision for Newport. Place where we can afford to live. We need stores. We need jobs. We had a good thing going in the city. It was called Community Commons. And this went on for 3, maybe 4 years. Once a month, we would bring in a subject. We could bring in, might be on safety, and we'd have all the police forces in the area come on board. It was hard to get people to go to the meetings. Many a time I would sit there and I'd look around and say, okay, there's 14 women and me. Maybe I better keep quiet. But that was good. And the community, the people that were there expressed their views. Nobody really attacked each other. And by my going, I learned a lot, just like with the daycares that the state come in and clamp down on them. Well, we have dedicated people who want to do this, but they can't watch the child and go to all the training that the state mandated on them. So, yeah, it's a hell of a thing trying to make this happen. Whatever we tried to get a warming shelter. And that was like 2 years of hard work. And everything you would try to do were roadblocks. But by attending these meetings, you learn a lot. And then you try to talk to the people that can maybe slow down these roadblocks. But I think that what I would like to see is more of like community commons, but it's hard to find somebody who wants to run it and then come up with the subjects. I think that's one of the best things that's happened in Newport in quite a few years. Like I said, I'd sit there many a night. It'd be discussions on women's issues. Well, I just usually kept quiet during things like that. But it was interesting what you can learn just by listening to what the people would say and how there's so many roadblocks to everything you want to try to do. But all you can do is keep talking and listening. And as my wife will attest, so I'm a heck of a listener. All right.
And we'll start down at the end with Dan Ross.
Well, my vision for Newport is to see something more vibrant. I grew up in a time when the city was very vibrant. But the city cannot be what it was in the past. So my vision is different today. I would like to see more emphasis on recreation. There's places now that are putting in lining roads with bike paths that are, they call them chevrons, where they're actually in the middle of the street on slow streets. It's a shared space. There's some slow streets in our town that could use those. We get a lot of bikers that go through town. They don't necessarily have a place to stop. A lot of them don't like to stop and go inside a restaurant. We've got to allow more outside on Main Street for the people that are on bikes. We've got to extend our bike paths as much as we can. I don't like to go down memory lane, but myself and Martin Fisher did the initial bike path that came to Newport. We did the land works that put the building on the waterfront. So these studies that we're talking about today do come to fruition, and we can see these things happen, but it takes the public getting involved and making it want to happen. Now, one of the other things, I want to make sure that when we talk about our city and we put things in brochures, that they're true. One of the statements is in the plan is remote section of Vermont. I don't like that statement. On our city website, if you go in, and I think it's under business, it says Newport is within 350 miles of major cities. Well, Newport is 216 miles from Boston, 100 and something from Manchester, 72 from Burlington, 106 from Montreal. Newport is not someplace out in space. Newport is close to all these things. We have an acceptable airport now. In today's technology, we can hunt for business that is not necessarily heavy industry or trucking. We have a Four Seasons resort. We've got to open up to everybody. You know, a tech firm is just as important as any other. But we do need businesses downtown.
And James Merriam is next.
Well, it could be summarized in one word. I would say home. Vision is home. That this is home and that this can be a home for many. I am originally from the Southern Northeast Kingdom, born and raised in Peacham, Vermont, just outside St. Johnsbury on a dirt road. And that was home, and it's a wonderful part of the world and a wonderful place to grow up. And I have ventured far afield. I've lived in about six different Vermont towns and two other states, and lived in the big city, in the big cities of Oakland, California, and Philadelphia, but always knew that I wanted eventually to go home. I had to go abroad, I had to go away to seek education in my particular fields, that there just wasn't the option to remain around here to do. But once you have seen the world, seen some adventure, you value home even more. And I think folks who have not, who don't know the Northeast Kingdom, recognize that as well. So many people retire here. But I had really never been to Newport in particular before the first opportunity to come up here to serve the United Church. And I came here for the first time and thought, no, this is home. This has everything Peacham has and so much more. Lake Nymphomaga just beats the crap out of Martin's Pond, tucked in under Killdevil Hill, on the edge of Peacham and Barnet any day of the week. But it's such an opportunity, it's such a wonder, and it's both for those who are here, those who have spent time here as children and return, who all of these groups are represented on this stage right now. But it feels like home, it fundamentally is home, and we need to present that and maintain that and extend that to an ever more broad array of people, both long-term residents, short-term residents, seasonal residents, tourists of all kinds of levels. We have an opportunity. It's an opportunity that brought me. It was a great, great job and a wonderful opportunity for my career, and I know that ministry work is not going to save this community, and I, by myself, am not the exemplar of just what we're trying to do, but I am the kind of young professional who was brought here because of an unmissable opportunity. And after time, my wife and I have made tremendous, a wonderful home here to help and contribute and to be a part of something that welcomes everyone.
All right, and Kevin
Chardon. We have many benefits in Newport. The bike path, the waterfront, the parks. Something we overlook and probably take for granted is we have an open government. It's not difficult to walk into the municipal building, to go up to James Johnson and the town clerk and ask him a question. Or if you have a different question of zoning or the city manager, you walk up to this and ask them. I've been to Burlington. It's not that easy to go in and talk to city officials. What would be nice is if everybody played nice together. That would be a benefit. One of the things, I grew up in Burlington, and right near the waterfront. When I was a boy, the waterfront had railroad tracks, giant oil storage tanks, and dolphins. But those are piers on the lake that the ships would unload their oil from. Now, if you go to the waterfront, it's wonderful. Restaurants, buildings, there's condominiums there. Coast Guard has built a new building. Development is happening. There are festivals and everything else on the waterfront. That didn't happen overnight. It happened one step at a time. And as Julie had mentioned, Newport needs to have a 5- and 10-year vision, a mission statement, so to speak. This needs to be reevaluated yearly to see where you are and where you're going. One of my favorite quotes is from, I'll paraphrase it, from St. Mother Teresa. You know, we all can't do great things, but everybody can do a small thing with great love. What does that mean? In a community, there are energetic, active people. What can we do? I'll tell you, how many people have a fire hydrant out front of their house? Shovel it. Benefits you, doesn't necessarily benefit the city. If your house burns down, they're gonna have to get to it. Little things like that, that if we do, you see your neighbor doing it, we work together, and we're building up Newport, that in turn will attract people when they sense that community.
All right. Well, that looks like our time, but we can mingle around a little bit afterwards, correct? But before we go, I want to do some thank yous. So first of all, I want to thank Newport VT Rocks for organizing this. Also, the Goodrich Memorial Library for hosting it. This is one of my favorite rooms in the Newport area. Penny Thomas for helping me with the questions and with the organization at the end, because that could have been disastrous if I was left to my own devices. WIKE for broadcasting this evening. This was on the radio tonight. Thank you for nobody swearing. That was fantastic. NEKTV's filming it. It will be broadcast next week on Channel 15. If you want to go to our Facebook page or NEKTVonline.com, the times will be there. And I'll be sure to get it to the newspapers as well. So, and we have to thank our candidates. Thank you very much, and thank you all for coming out this evening. Don't forget, Town Meeting Day is March 6th, and have a great night. Drive safe. Thank you. Thank you.